Jesus Christ be with you all. Welcome to worship here at Oglethorpe Presbyterian Church. Whether you are with us online or here in person, it is a blessing to worship together. If you are with us on Facebook, please let us know you're here. Send in any prayer requests and share this page on your page so that the rest of your online community can worship with us too. All right, and for those of you in the chapel, you will find prayer cards and visitor cards in the pew rack, so please use those as applicable. Church, I rarely note birthdays in worship, but when a birthday falls on a Sunday, And when it has a zero in it, I'm not above asking y'all to help me wish Brock Timmons a happy birthday. Almost as much fun as that, our Rainbow Doors project is now underway. And the morning session accomplished so much with the help of the heat, actually. The first coat of paint just dried. We got a second coat on. So we will not be working on the rainbow doors after worship because A, the work is done, and B, it's just too hot after noon today. So the rest of the work party will be next Sunday before worship. And we'll have tasks figured out for everybody by then and communicated. But we won't be working outside after worship today. All right, as usual, our serve team has lots of opportunities, and I think Rachel is going to update us on those.
Well, first of all, thank you to everyone who participated in the blood drive this past Wednesday. We had 30 donors, including 4 new ones, and there were 33 units of blood donated, which potentially saves 99 lives. So thank you again. We continue to hold our necessities card drive for the Souther Center. We have these wonderful cards with essential items on them, and we'll put them in the back there. Please take one and shop for it this week and bring it back next Sunday. I learned recently that the element of choice in a food pantry provides people with dignity. A lot of our customers come through, and this may be their first time coming through a food pantry and asking for help. And both the drive-through model and the element of choice offer them dignity. So remember that as you're thinking about them. On July 14th, we will take our necessity items to the Souther Center after worship. All are invited to help us. And once we're there, the space has been reserved for our church. And please help us to sort the items and to make bags for people. Thank you.
Thank you, and yes, thank you all who've been participating in all this stuff. All right, at the end of today's service, session has called a congregational meeting for the sole purpose of electing this year's nominating committee. Members of OPC are asked to stay and vote. Visitors are welcome to stick around. It will be very brief. And finally, folks are in and out of town, of course, during the summer, but the bills of the church do not take a vacation, so please be sure that your pledges are up to date. Church, all of this is part of how we worship God, and Ed is going to add something to this.
Yes, at the end of June, Happy New Year as well, so I want to thank everybody here because we are being balanced. We're not ahead, we're not behind, but in the end of the doldrums of summer, we're still there, and we will be issuing in July or May as my year report, so we know where we are. You're doing well, and I appreciate all of everybody here and people that are not here who donated to our church.
Amen. Yes, those of you who are worshiping with us online, thank you for the money that comes in, whether you're in person or not. All right, right now we are blessed to move into a moment of stillness as the Christ candle is lit.
Please rise in body and poor spirit and join in the call to worship printed in the bulletin. God is a refuge in times of trouble.
Yes, O Lord, you do not forsake those who seek you.
Those who know your name, O God, put their trust in you.
Let us sing praises to the Lord who is our God.
Let our lives proclaim to all people the great things God has done.
Let us worship God.
Let us worship God.
sin, we say that. We don't fool ourselves. The truth is not in us, and we are lost in complete state of confusion. But God loves us enough to hear our confessions, help us understand our situation, and forgive us. Always forgive us. Confident of that forgiveness, we come before God using the words of the confession prayer that's printed in your bulletin. Almighty God, who long ago heard David's prayers, hear our prayers today. We see fearsome threats destroying the wondrous world, and we hear derisive voices diminishing or changing on the margins. We want to be brave on behalf of your reign, but we are not. We want to trust the gifts you have given us, but we do not. Instead, we make excuses and sneak away. Forgive us. Strengthen our faith and give us courage to step forward as your people, trusting in your power working through us. Amen. God is for us, who is against us? God prevails against all opposing forces. God forgives us and makes us new. And as the forgiven people of God, we are free to share the peace of Christ with one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let's rise and share signs of peace. Holiday somewhere, and so we will proceed with the proclamation of the word.
Let's pray. God of all, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Amen. Our first reading is from Mark chapter 4, 35 to 41. On that day, when evening had come, Jesus said to the disciples, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
The passage Georgia just read for us is not a story of Jesus is just this one little guy and yet he could shut down a great big storm. The story is bigger than that. The story is about how the loving power of God that flows through Jesus is stronger than anything. Storms, sin, death. And it's about Jesus' ability to trust the presence of that loving power, even though folks around him, folks like us, struggle to believe such good news. And similarly, the story that we're about to hear is not about David being just one little guy, and if he could kill great big Goliath with nothing but a slingshot. It's bigger than that. It's about how the loving power of God could work through David, and how David trusted God, even when faith was wearing thin for those around him. I will confess that I have never preached on any David's story, because I instinctively dislike David. We'll get to the Bathsheba story in a couple of weeks. But even while preparing for this sermon, whenever I read David's stories, I can't help lumping him in with the kind of guys that I've been avoiding since high school. But the story is way bigger than me, and it's bigger than David. For 3,000 years, the story of David has mattered to the storytellers of the Israelites. Most importantly, it mattered to that storytelling savior who just shut down that great big storm. You see, when the angel Gabriel visits Mary to tell her that she will conceive and carry, birth and nurture the Son of God, here's how the world is first told about Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor, David. That's how much bigger than David this story is. So with that perspective, let's hear this story that is one of the most well-known in all the Bible. And as you hear it today, notice the ways that human power is depicted, as well as the ways that God's power is depicted. And yeah, you can also pay attention to David. This is 1 Samuel chapter 17, starting with verses 4 through 11. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and his shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistine said, "Today I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man that we may fight together." When King Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. The text goes on to say that Goliath comes out and repeats his threatening taunt every morning and every evening for 40 days. We pick up the story in verse 32. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are just a boy, and he's been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth. And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, since he has defied the armies of the living God." David said, "The Lord, who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, will save me from the hand of this Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Saul clothed David with his own armor, put a bronze helmet on his head, and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in his shepherd's bag in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and who drew near? The Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by the Philistines' gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day, the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air and the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear. For the battle is the Lord's, and God will give you into our hand." When the Philistine drew nearer to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. This too is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, so this famous story that is, yes, about David, is about the working of human power and the working of God's power, and the times when, through faith and trust and grace, those powers coincide. That is what lifts this from folktale pseudo-history into lived theology. So church, let's look at these depictions of human power and of God power. The story starts with human power. Two armies drawn up for battle, Philistines versus Israelites. Now the books of Samuel recount Israel's startlingly swift transformation from a decentralized collection of tribes into a nation state more or less unified under an anointed monarch. King Saul is their first king. David will be their second. And one of the reasons the Israelites pestered God to give them a king instead of being satisfied with the God-appointed judges who had so long led them is that they were always at risk of attack, notably from the Philistines. In fact, the Philistines had been so successful in their military raids against the Israelites that in addition to capturing territory and the typical spoils of war, the Philistines also managed to capture the Ark of the Covenant. That's the magnitude of this threat. And in today's story, that Philistine threat is distilled into the person of Goliath, large and loud and accessorized with his own shield bearer. The narrator first focuses on Goliath's suit of bronze armor that historians estimate would have weighed somewhere in the neighborhood of 150 pounds. Then attention is paid to his bronze weaponry. Next, the narrator adds the detail that the head of Goliath's spear was more than 15 pounds of iron. What matters there is that a few chapters earlier, the biblical writer noted that the Israelites had no blacksmiths. They could not forge iron implements. So Goliath's iron spear point, which is to say his capable of piercing bronze spear point, is like an advanced weapons system. Human power. Human power continues on display in the speech of this bragging bully as he promises to fight and kill, and if I prevail, then y'all shall serve us, which is problematic for those who are covenanted to serve only God. These taunts succeed in overwhelming the Israelite soldiers and their king with abject dread. But the words do not intimidate David, whose response references the living God. Saul has tragically lost touch with that power, but David's connection with God is really something. That's at least part of why reading the books of Samuel is like hearing the ancient Hebrews run out of adjectives for this champion of theirs. Here, David escalates the rhetoric of human power while also introducing the rhetoric of God power. His tale of lambs and lions and bears concludes with the hands-on violence of catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. But David duly attributes his success to God. The Lord, who saved me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear. David does deeds, but he trusts God's delivering power. Moved by the boy's speech, King Saul initially echoes David's word of faith, saying, "May the Lord be with you." But then the king immediately reverts to reliance on human power as he equips David with his royal armor and sword. Faith in God is well and good, but Saul still relies on the human power of the weapons he has at hand. And if that sounds at all familiar to you, you and Saul are not alone. We exist in a reality infinitely bigger than ourselves, and yet again and again we fall back on worldly power. Maybe that's why this is the one moment David manages to capture a bit of my heart. He realizes he cannot make it through by relying on Saul's manifestations of human power. Even as they are too big for him, He needs something bigger than them. And so David sheds Saul's warrior bronze and picks up the pieces of his true self, the tools of the shepherd boy he was when God first took notice of him. Rather than trying to be like Saul, which is like Goliath, David gathers 5 smooth stones and goes to meet Israel's adversary with nothing more than that and trust in the power of God. Now, human power, stubborn thing that it is, gets one more errand, one more escalation, one more, oh yeah? Goliath jeers, I will give your corpse to be eaten by wild animals. And David does join in on this lurid rhetoric, but listen to his emphasis. You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, human power, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, God power. And then, even while echoing the brutality of Goliath's threats by retorting, I will strike you down and cut off your head, David embeds his declaration of human power within a flurry of declarations of God's power. Listen again. The Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head and give the Philistine armies to be eaten by the wild animals, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and so that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear. David's purpose is not merely Israelite victory over the Philistines. His purpose is bigger. It's the purpose is that God's power be known and trusted. That's the point of both of today's stories. There are threatening powers in our earthly lives, church. All sorts of storms, all sorts of bullies. But there is also the power of God in our lives. Goliath may be bigger than David, but God's loving power is infinitely bigger than us all. Reading this story might tempt us to see ourselves in David. We can feel small. Our beloved OPC is small. And we sometimes feel threatened by the priorities of human power. Furthermore, we are told to dress up in what the world wants us to be. But if we're wise, we'll rely on our own 5 smooth stones, the gifts of our truest self. That line of thinking can be interesting to ponder, but remember, this story is bigger. Or reading this story might let us see ourselves in Goliath. We are, after all, citizens of the most powerful nation on earth. We are increasingly conditioned by public figures to brag and to bully and to resort to violent words and violent deeds. We are clad in an assortment of privilege, and there are vulnerable people within our reach. That line of thinking can also be interesting to ponder. But remember, this story is bigger. This story, like the story of Jesus in that storm-swamped boat, is about the loving power of God and how that power can flow through those who trust in it. It is not about God working for us. It's about God deigning to work through us. Not so that God will do our will, but so that we can be part of doing God's will, which can happen when faith aligns with that gracious will, and we manage to trust it, as Jesus did. And yes, as David did. Even he knew that it was bigger than him. Amen.
God is always at work, and we are called to be part of God's works of generosity and grace, called to give time, talent, and treasure to God's ongoing mission. We are called to give, and God promises to receive. The morning offering will now be given and received.
As we sing this song, it's going to be a song familiar to many of you, so feel free to sing along. We have changed the third verse to be more gender inclusive, and here we go.
Holy One, receive these offerings as you receive our lives. Make good use of all that we are so that our lives show forth your glory. Amen.
You may be seated. We come now to a time of our community prayer. So if there are any joys or concerns, I've received one card, but if there are others, let me know. Jen. Friends and family of Melissa. All right, thank you. I'm sorry to hear that. Eleanor.
I've place was joy over Bart's birthday and the fact that I have had 47 birthdays with him.
Indeed. All right. Well, with all that and more in our hearts and minds, let us come before God in prayer. God of grace and God of glory, thank you for your wondrous creation and all the extravagant evidence of your handiwork. Teach us to respect and care for the earth and for all the life you have created. Please, O God, bless every region of this, your broken yet beloved world. In particular, we lift to you the war in Ukraine, the disaster in Gaza, the chaos in Haiti. Grant wisdom to all leaders as they work, that they may work effectively for peace and justice. Please, O God, heal the painful divisions in our own nation, whether political, racial, economic, familial. As a presidential debate comes to our own city, help us all remember that Jesus calmed the storm. Help us all remember that you endure beyond human power and that you deign to work through us. O God, work through us as we care for the most vulnerable. Work through us as we show up in the world in ways that reflect your inclusive grace. We lift to you those who suffer in body, mind, and spirit, those experiencing food insecurity, homelessness, unemployment, sickness, loneliness, and all the ailments that steal hope. May your church be useful to you in offering practical aid as evidence of your transcendent loving power. God of grace and God of glory, we now commend to you our own dear ones, the family and friends of Melissa Daniels, Brock's birthday, and the Timmons' ongoing marriage, Walter Evans facing heart surgery, Carolyn Rainey dealing with a tumor, Mary Shanks at the death of her sister-in-law, and all of the needs known only to you. May all your beloved children and all our dear ones daily know your loving presence. All this we pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray.
Thank you.
Church's work is always part of how we worship God, and so we will conduct today's meeting within the framework of today's worship service. Any OPC members who are here with us in person or online can vote, and those of you who are online, you can use the chat function for any questions and to vote. So I call this congregational meeting to order, and I ask that our acting clerk confirm that there is a quorum present. Great, thank you. Then let us open the meeting in prayer. Holy God, you are the head of the church. Bless this, the work of your body. Be with us and guide us so that our shared life is a true reflection of our faith and trust in you. In Jesus' name we pray, and all gathered say,
Amen.
Amen. Because our stated clerk of session can't be here today, he asked a former clerk, Miriam Hawthorne, to fill in, and she has graciously agreed. We do, however, need to make that official. So I need a motion and a second that we accept Mary Ann as acting clerk for this congregational meeting.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, thank you. All right, the sole stated purpose of this meeting is to elect this year's nominating committee, comprised of one current member of session, one current deacon, and one member at large. The proposed session member is Jen Sterner Allison. The proposed deacon is Eleanor Timmons. And the proposed member at large is Bill Cox. Are there any nominations from the floor? Please bear in mind that anyone you nominate must have already agreed to serve if elected. Okay, with no additional nominations, is there any discussion? All right. Then, with no discussion needed, all in favor of electing Jen, Eleanor, and Bill to be our nominating committee, please raise your hand or vote yes in the chat.
We all have all yeses in the chat.
All the yeses in the chat, thank you. All right, any opposed, please raise your hand, vote no. All right, the motion passes. Thank you, Eleanor and Jen and Bill, for your willingness to serve in this way, and I look forward to working with you as ex officio as we discern and recruit the new class of OPC officers. All right, the business of this congregational meeting being complete, can I get a motion to adjourn? A second?
Second.
All in favor, please rise for the benediction. Go out into this world that needs the power of God working always, to know that your power is nothing to that power, and yet your power can be used by that power. So align yourself with the will of God and feel that power and trust that power to move through you. And as you do, may you know the everlasting love of the one true God, who is the source, the Son, and the Spirit, this day and always. To believe, but there is one more item that's not official, but it is important. Mark Kelly.
Nick, your OPC family wanted to celebrate your new home and wanted to give you this.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Just real quick, thank you to Mark and Donnie for making it happen.
You don't have birthday cake, but we have birthday mail bread.